Welcome to the 15th video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. In this chapter, we talk about spin models, and you can't do spin models without the Ising model. That's a picture of Ising on the far left. The model was actually first thought of by his thesis advisor, Lenz, so I include a photo of Lenz as well. And one of the interesting things that you have here are when you see level crossings and things as a function of magnetic field. These are some of the types of questions that we will examine in looking at interacting spin models. So chapter 10, Ising and XY models of interacting spins. This is a chapter that you often don't see in any quantum mechanics textbook. And I think it's a real shame because once you've developed all of this theory of angular momentum, it's really a natural to start looking at interacting spin models. So we do cover the Ising model, and that includes both the traditional Ising model and the Ising model in a transverse field, which is often viewed as one of the simplest interacting models in quantum mechanics. We study the XY model, which extends the directions at which the spins interact from just one axis, which is what you have in the Ising model, to two axes in the XY model. We then look at a really important approach using what's called the Jordan-Wigner transformation and fermionization that allows us to solve these problems exactly. In essence, what we do is we map the spin onto non-interacting fermions, and by working with the fermions, we can exactly solve the spin problems. This also provides an opportunity to introduce you to second quantization and fermionic operators, which we will be using later in the book as well. We then discuss a model that many people don't know, the Lipkin-Meshkov-Glick model. This is a wonderful model that allows us to actually get the exact solution of the quantum problem, even when we have a large number of spins, like 100 spins, which you could never do for, say, Ising model or XY model that can't be solved by fermionization because the Hilbert space is too large. But there's a special property of the Lipkin-Meshkov-Glick model. It commutes with the total angular momentum, and that allows you to characterize your states in terms of total angular momentum, and that reduces the Hilbert space tremendously. And then we end with a discussion of the Dickey model. This is an interaction of spin with vibrations in a crystal or with photons. And it is a very common model to be investigated in ion traps. And there's lots of rich behavior in it. So it's a really interesting model to look at. All right, let's go browse through the chapter. This chapter starts with a quote from Salvador Dali, who is an artist. "I want to perceive and understand the hidden powers and laws of things in order to have them in my power. I can't think of a better subject that has hidden powers and laws in it than quantum mechanics." And as you study quantum mechanics, you then are able to understand and be able to work with them. I would say it gives you a new perspective on things that others just don't have who've never studied or understood and worked with quantum mechanics. All right, so we start off with an introduction to lattices because spin models take place on lattices, and most people haven't really looked at or studied lattices. This is just a periodic arrangement of sites where the spins will sit. And because it's periodic, that allows us to do a number of simplifications when we're solving the problem that we couldn't do if it was just some collection of points that the spins sit on with no structure to them. Then we work with the Ising model itself. This was a problem that was given by Wilhelm Lenz to his student Ernst Ising, and he wanted to use it to study phase transitions. And what Ising did was he proved that there's no phase transition for the one-dimensional model. So he must have had some angst when he was doing his PhD that essentially his PhD didn't work out the way that it was supposed to. This is a common thing that can happen in doing research. Here is the Ising model itself. We have the interaction of the Z component of the spin between what is typically neighboring sites.
But you could have long-range versions of the Ising model where you're interacting pairs between more distant sites as well. This is an example of some small cluster lattices that we can exactly solve the Ising model on, and we talk about those kinds of solutions in the chapter. We look at some of the different symmetries that the Ising model has, and we also look at what the consequences of those symmetries are. We look at interesting kinds of lattices. These are called Lieb lattices, the one on the right is a Lieb lattice. They're bipartite lattices because the lines only connect the white and the gray sites. Bipartite lattices play an important role in a number of the things that we'll do in the book. Here we're looking at the property of frustration when you have anti-ferromagnetic interactions, so the spins want to be aligned oppositely, but you have triangular connections on your lattice. You cannot have the three spins all opposite to each other in pairs, and because of that you get a degeneracy where these three different configurations will all share the same energy. There's lots of interesting quantum mechanics that occurs when you have these degenerate states, especially when you add small perturbations that will break the degeneracy, and exactly how the system responds to those small perturbations is a very interesting problem that lots of people are interested in studying. In one dimension, you have a spin excitation that can actually separate, and this creates what's called a fractional spin excitation. And this is a picture that gives you a very easy way of understanding what a fractional spin excitation is. This is, again, something that is very common to study in different kinds of spin models. We have a number of problems to get you used to working with the Ising model. Ising model in a longitudinal field is a relatively simple problem to examine, but it does have things called level crossings that occur, and that's a interesting topic that is worthwhile discussing, why and when you can have level crossings. And then we move into the Jordan-Wigner transformation and fermionization. It turns out this is what you need to solve the Ising model. We explain carefully how that works. This was worked out in detail in the early 1960s by Lieb, Schultz, and Mattis in an absolutely beautiful paper, which I highly recommend you read. The reference is, of course, available in the book. We cover just a small subset of what's in that article. We talk a bit about the properties of fermions because this is not something I expect you to know. And then once you've done this Jordan-Wigner transformation, you can then use that fermionization to solve these different models. It turns out the XY model is easier to solve than the Ising model, so we start with the XY model. XY model involves interactions in two spatial dimensions rather than the single dimension that the spins are interacting in for the Ising model. Now, the dimensions that the spins interact in and the dimensions of the lattice are totally different things. So you can have an XY model in one dimension, two dimensions, three dimensions, just like you can have an Ising model in one dimension, two dimensions, three dimensions. The dimensions I was talking about were the dimensions over which the spin interactions occur. So in an XY model, you'll have terms that involve sigma x at one site with a sigma x on another site, and a sigma y on one site and a sigma y on another site, whereas the Ising model would just have it in one dimension, say just the x components. These are showing you energy diagrams, and what you can see if you look carefully at this is the ground state, which is the black curve at the bottom, has a number of phase transitions in it, where we really call them level crossings, where the system changes its quantum numbers from one value to another at each of those different level crossings. And you can work out some nice formulas that tell you exactly when that will occur. Okay, we then move on to the transverse field Ising model. This is one of the most heavily studied models in quantum mechanics, particularly looking at the dynamics of different kinds of transverse field Ising models in numerics. People love to do this because the numerics is not that hard, but it has in it a lot of the general properties that interacting quantum systems have. So this is a model that lots of people love to study. We give you a nice introduction to this here, and we also show you how you solve it with fermionization. It is a bit more complicated. You have to use something called a Bogle-Yubov transformation. Here's a picture of Bogle-Yubov, the famous Ukrainian physicist. He's sometimes referred to as a Russian physicist, but he is from Ukraine, and I certainly want to recognize that he is Ukrainian, not Russian. Then after we look at the XY model, we look at the Lipkin-Meshkov-Glick model. Lipkin-Meshkov-Glick model is one where the interactions that you have are between all pairs of sites with an equal value. So that Jij in this expression here is actually a constant. It doesn't change. It's not a function of I and J. You have to do an appropriate scaling to get all of the properties of the model to be appropriate when you take the limit as n gets very large. But you can solve this model for a huge number of spins, like a few hundred, maybe even a few thousand on a conventional laptop computer. So it's a very nice model to study. It's a model that was looked at very carefully in the context of nuclear physics because they thought it would be a way of describing some of the shell models in nuclear physics. I'm not sure it worked. I'm not a nuclear physicist, so I'm not sure that it worked incredibly well. Then we have the Dickey model. And I also put in here a picture of Serge Hirosh in addition to Dickey, because Serge Hirosh has done a lot of interesting stuff on related models to the Dickey model. He has worked on what's called cavity QED. That's when he won his Nobel Prize for. And cavity QED is a beautiful set of experiments that we discuss a little bit here, and then also in the last chapter of the book. And there's a lot of interesting physics and a lot of interesting math that is associated with the Dickey model. This is a model that can be looked at in ion traps, and this is a figure from a recent paper that I have working with experimentalists who are actually simulating the Dickey model in an ion trap. And I share that rather recent research work with you in the book. It's fairly easy and straightforward to understand, so you don't have to worry about it being too advanced. It's really cool stuff, these spin models, and I hope that you enjoy them when you get to this chapter, chapter 10 in the book. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.